Hi, everybody. Welcome to Bulletproof Underwear, episode number 113. Yeah!
All right.
I am your co-host, Yam Juice.
And I am your co-host, Flex.
And today we've got, for the first time ever, we've got our guest, a legend in the Halo community, a YouTuber. He's got some great videos out there, and he's just a really, really nice guy. We've got Mr. Crazed Spartan! Yeah! All right.
Buddy.
Welcome.
Hey, thanks for having me. I really do appreciate that.
Oh, for sure, for sure. We couldn't have this show without you, baby.
Well, I just discovered this show, and the ones I've watched, especially the Halo ones, I really, really enjoy. So,
All right.
I've watched Elementaries, Majors, and a bunch of other ones, too. We really like it.
We both just started getting into Halo. Yam's into it more. I'm more of a noob than him, so, but... I'm really liking it. I mean, I haven't played it a lot in the past. I played a little bit of Reach, which I didn't think was that great, but I'm liking it.
Reach was probably not the most well-received game in the Halo history, but we had that huge tournament yesterday. Well, it's not a huge tournament, but I think you guys probably watched some of that.
Oh, I watched quite a bit of it.
Yeah, that was like phenomenal.
Well, it was cool seeing it played at the high level. I'll tell you what, they play a very campy style. They don't move very much.
I was surprised.
Yeah, I mean, most of the time they were just like the first person to go forward was going to get their ass kicked.
Very, 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 very tactical.
Yeah, usually Lockout definitely plays that way, period. I think Yam Juice, when we played Lockout the other night, you probably would have noticed that we kind of tend to stay on the towers and kind of wait for the other team to move and try to keep top control. Lockout does play a little campier, but Sanctuary, right. If you watch the other one, what was it, Gamescom, that was even better. That was a far better matchup, I thought.
Right, right. Well, these are the top players, and there's money on the line and prestige, so they're not going to take any chances. You know, they're gonna play much more careful probably than just regular pubs are going to be.
Oh yeah, yeah. Regular pub stomping, you can just kind of just go in there and do what you want, but there's money on the line, so you want to win.
Right. Yeah. Also, this was the first time we got a chance to see Lockout interactive elements being actually used in a game. What do you think about that?
I like it. I really do. For those that don't like it, I mean, we can forge around it. I don't know if you guys know about Forge yet or not.
Know a little bit, yeah.
Well, that's good. But I really like the effects. I've always loved interactive features in Halo games. They've had it in the past. Halo 3 had a lot. Halo 4 just kind of went away from that, and so did Halo Reach. And then it looks like you're going to be bringing it back, which is really, really cool.
Right, right. They've added six maps, six yet to be announced, and every one of them, I think. Has every one of them had some new element added to it?
Yes. We know of a few of them, I think. Coagulation, which is the Blood Gulch remake. We don't know what that one is. It looks like some interactive bridge. How that's going to play into that map, I don't know. Right. They haven't shown it yet.
And that dome shield thing that you can activate. Yeah.
Yeah, that looks like it's going to be a nice interactive feature to play. I really, really am enjoying what they're doing. And the maps just look amazing. Oh, my God.
They do.
Oh,
they
man. Do. I was blown
their
away.
Their stream looked good. Oh, I've never seen a Twitch stream ever look that good.
I went to Source video when I was watching it yesterday on Twitch. And, oh, my God, you got the full 60 frames per second, 1080p. Oh, it looks
sweet. It was amazing. It looks so good. I've never seen a stream. Nobody's stream on Twitch has ever looked that good. That was blew me away.
They had the good servers running.
Then I clicked over to the major stream, for a little bit, and it's like,
oh yeah,
oh yeah, not the same.
Oh, Major Stream, he's got worse internet than I do, or just right on par. So yeah, his stream isn't going to be all that good. I think he runs at the lowest settings.
Yeah, like 360 or something like that.
Enough to that you can see it and enjoy it.
Yeah. Well, you know, to be honest with you, my favorite part of watching the Major stream is his commentary, you know, when he's talking.
Yeah, I like to chat with him when I can. I can actually chat with him more on that than when I actually get online to play, because he's in the UK and I am not. So he's going to bed by the time I actually get online.
Yeah, well, he's got pretty crazy hours. If you look at, sometimes he'll be streaming, it'll be like 2 o'clock, 2:30 in the morning his time.
Yeah, it's about time I'm usually up, so I'm a late night guy. I'm always late.
So what state are you in?
I'm actually in Wisconsin. And
okay.
Hey, I'm so in Minnesota. Neighbors.
Okay, so yeah. Central time zone. So you're 2 hours ahead of me, and I'm in Oakland. So if you're a late night guy, that's good, because all of my friends are in the dadgum East Coast and they go to bed so soon.
Yeah. See, I work third shift, so when I get home and I just stay on that schedule. I don't try to switch over. So I'm up usually till probably about 4, maybe 5 in the morning sometimes.
Well, that's good. That's good. You get actually a chance to play with some of those UK guys.
A little bit. Like I said, Major, by the time I get on, is around 9, 10 o'clock, and that's probably about 4 o'clock his time, so he might catch him, might not.
Yeah.
Silly Major. He should just move to the U.S. and be done with it.
I know, for God's sakes. Jesus. So you've been putting out some videos, a lot of videos with callouts, and like not the last one, but the one before that, you had a guest, Rapscallion, did the commentary for it. Are you like so busy that you've got to farm it out?
No, I could do every single one, but I don't want to. I like so many other YouTube personalities. Rapscallion is one. I liked Elite Assassin. He did a couple of them. I just like their personalities, and I just want to help their channels as much as I possibly can, because
that's cool.
You know, I'm not a huge channel, but I do want to help everybody that I can. I mean, that's a nice person that I get along with. There's other people out there that I probably wouldn't want to help because they're very critical and harsh. I want to say harsh is probably a good word for it. But that's my goal, and that's why I usually click a like button when I watch a video and everything, because I want to support them as much as I can.
Yeah, well, you've really helped out Bulletproof Underwear. You clicked like on many of them, and we've gained some subscribers just because of you. Thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome.
Yeah, well, I don't think a lot of people in Halo sort of knew this channel exists, because it's not the same channel as mine. We have a separate channel for Bulletproof Underwear.
Yeah, I think you focused on what? You focused on more of a Call of Duty side for a while?
Yeah. I was a Call of Duty guy, and Flex as well.
I was too. Was.
Yeah, I've played Call of Duty in my day. I can't say I haven't.
Well, most Halo players have played some. I don't know. Which Call of Duties did you play?
I generally played... I played Black Ops, Modern Warfare 3, Black Ops 2 would probably be the main ones that I've played. Mm-hmm. I've had all the others and played them. But yeah, I play Call of Duty. I have some friends that are just diehard Call of Duty fans. My brother is a diehard Call of Duty fan. We get into the Halo versus COD conversation just about every time we get around to it.
Well, I don't know why, but when I was playing Call of Duty, I was like really in love with it, and I like the idea of Halo. It just at that time it didn't appeal to me at all. It's like I don't know what it was about it. It just like nah, Halo's not for me.
It was new to you. You didn't
right. It's a different game.
But great. I hadn't played it. The thing is, I hadn't played it. And then when I finally just got fed up so much beyond any redemption whatsoever with Call of Duty Ghost. I was like looking around. I played Titanfall. I liked Titanfall, but I knew it wasn't the answer. So that's when I actually gave Halo 4 a try. And it's like, at first, you know, I wasn't really super grooving on it, but I gave it some time, and it's like, you know what, this is addicting. And it's like, before I knew it,
yeah,
I'm like completely fucking in love with Halo.
Well, you know what, I think Halo, and granted Halo 4 is probably the least where this shows a skill gap. In Halo, when you play and you can really see yourself come in as the noob, and I have seen this. I've watched your videos, Yamjuice. I've seen your first ones, and I've gone through them, and I've already seen improvement, and you can see it. It's amazing to watch a player come in from a complete noob and advance. I'm probably an above average player. I wouldn't say I'm a pro by any means. I've gone against Unishek. He was in that tournament yesterday, and Unishek just wipes the floor with me. It's not even pretty. But that's what I like about Halo so much, is that there's so much to learn. There's so many little things that you can pick up and it's like improve your game, learning things like the way the maps flow, where to be, your weapon timers, all the other little intricacies like jumps and stuff like that. Stuff I still don't even know. And I've played Halo 4 since its launch. There's just so much to learn. And that's what I think really intrigues people when they actually do start playing.
Let me take a side bar here. Let's talk about your actual gaming history. What got you into gaming, and when was that?
I was a young pup. I'll just say that. What got me into gaming is this. I always enjoyed it. I loved playing games, and I was good at it.
First platform?
This is going to date me a little bit. The Atari 2600.
Yes! 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 Me too!
I remember playing Space Invaders and the Pac-Man game. I played that until the cows came home. It was so good. I don't know why.
Till you broke the button on the joystick.
Yeah, oh, yeah, I broke several joysticks.
The joystick had one thing and one handle and one button.
Yeah, one button and a stick.
Yeah,
that was it.
And it was square, and it dug a hole in your hand. It's like, oh my God, it's so painful. After you've been playing for a few hours, it's like, I need a Band-Aid.
I was a kid, so it didn't matter to me. I was going to play.
Yep.
All right, so you got a nice early start. You're OG, baby. You're a video gamer.
Old guy? Yeah.
Yeah.
I am.
Original gangsta.
I'll go with that.
All right, yeah. So what was the first multiplayer game that you started playing?
Multiplayer, that's far down the line. I mean, I didn't even play I didn't even play Halo CE multiplayer wise. I didn't play Call of Duty, not because I didn't want to, it's just because my job at the time just really didn't allow for it. Just because it was just no internet type of stuff and nothing like that. My first real multiplayer game, I would honestly say, and this was LAN set up, so it would probably be GoldenEye.
So that's credentials. That's solid credentials there.
Yep.
And we set it up in this little back room, and we played that game all night. I mean, we would set up nights for playing it, and we just would switch out and whatever else, and we would just be up all night, grab some food, grab some chips and soda, and that's what we were doing all night. It was good times. I loved it.
Oh yeah.
All right, so first online not LAN, what's the first games that you got into?
It would be Halo. Definitely Halo, because I played. Actually, I didn't. I'm going to take that back. It's not Halo. The first online games that I actually played would probably be more of the strategy games. I played Command & Conquer, if you remember that.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I played that a lot. And I also played StarCraft and WarCraft. I mean, I loved the strategy games. I played those for quite a long time. Then my friend got me into World of Warcraft later on down the line.
Oh, no, no!
The time burner.
Yeah, I still play World of Warcraft, so...
Oh, my God, he's a nerd! He's a nerd, Flex!
I am a nerd, I will admit it.
Just
my
kidding.
My wife will admit it.
Just kidding. All right, so you are known in the community as, like, the go-to expert on Halo's lore. Okay, so how did you get into that?
Well, I just really enjoyed the backstory. I mean, we had the all the campaigns and everything else like that, which was great. But I just felt like there was some more to it. I wanted to know who the Forerunners were. I wanted to know why the Covenant was doing what they were doing and why we were at ends with each other. I mean, honestly, if you just play the games, all you know is that the Covenant is just bound and determined to destroy humanity.
Right.
So why? Why did they want to just destroy us? What was the point? And by reading the books and reading the all the other stuff that goes with it, you get to really understand what's going on. And that's what I really enjoy. I like knowing what the backstory of people is. Plus, there's just so many good stories out there. I mean, one of the games that probably isn't the most popular game out there, but it was Halo ODST. I loved that game. Absolutely loved it. Easily one of my favorite campaigns of all time.
Takes place before Halo CE, right?
Yeah, it takes place right around the time of Halo 2.
Oh, okay, so it's not before. Oh, Reach is the one that happens before.
Yeah, Reach happens before. Now, that's just where I have a problem with Bungie, and a lot of people probably would... I don't know if they would hate on me for this, but I did have a problem with Bungie because Bungie did not monitor that stuff as much as they should have. They just kind of let the other authors kind of run with it. That's why there is some extreme inconsistencies between the original games and the original books. And they just don't match up. 343 took a different stance on that. And they said, we're going to make everything that comes out, it is going to be canon. It is going to be part of the story. It might be a long story, might be side stories. Doesn't matter. They're making it all matter, which is, I think, is a good thing. I'm really glad they're doing that.
Right,
Makes stuff work so much better.
So ODST was, you know, I actually have a copy of ODST and a copy of Reach. I haven't broken into him yet because I've been doing Halo 4. I did also get Halo CE Anniversary, and I played the campaign, and I really, really enjoyed that. And I cannot wait to get my hands on Halo 2's campaign.
Oh, I can't wait to play all those games again on my big screen, because I have a big screen now, and in 1080p. 60 frames per second. I mean, we got to see it technically at PAX yesterday because they showed a little bit of Halo 3's campaign, but it was a stream, so, you know, you can't really tell. At least I couldn't. But watching the other stream, when I did put that up to source and the actual multiplayer side, oh, my God, it's just going to be so smooth. I just can't even wait. Definitely going to be so fun to go right back through that entire campaign. I'm going to do the grind. I am. I'm going to do Halo CE all the way to Halo 4, legendary settings.
Oh, my God. So, everybody, be on the lookout. There is going to be a lot of videos coming from the Spartan.
Actually, I'm going to be working with someone else. I'm actually going to be working with Frozen Sword on that, I think. We're going to be doing a Let's Play. I don't think we'll do it on legendary settings when I do work with him, but we're planning on going through the entire campaign and putting it on his channel.
Oh, on his channel? Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, I like his channel. I like his channel. He's, can I get a bull? Yeah!
Can I get a bull? Yeah!
Yeah, he's kind of a nut, and his raps are imaginative. Let's just say they're imaginative.
Unique.
Yeah, I don't think Dr. Dre has got to worry too much.
No, probably not. And he keeps trying to get me to sing along, and just I'm no singer. Granted, he would argue the fact that he's not either, but you know, I'm good with it. I don't need to torture people.
Okay, so he is definitely up on Halo lore. Now, every single video he makes, he always says, "Hi, this is Southern Gamer Frozen Sword, the king of Halo lore, because I beat the Crazed Spartan in a lore off." He always says that.
Yeah, yes, he does.
Did he actually beat you?
We did have another channel. It was on. It was called the Behind the Bullet Network, or the BTB Network. Unfortunately, it got hacked, and absolutely. Every video was destroyed, and the originator, Buckeye Bree, has just decided to get rid of it, and he's now working with Halo Follower now. So
that sucks, man.
But it was there, and I had a lot of videos on there. I probably was one of the few that probably uploaded consistently. So I lost a lot of stuff. And I referenced a lot of my own videos over two of those videos. So, wasn't too happy with that. I really wasn't.
That's a damn shame. So, Buckeye is the one who founded that.
Yep, Buckeye did. Buckeye founded the BTB network, but it is no longer in existence anymore.
Oh.
That's lame, man. I don't understand why people do crap like that, man.
I don't know. I don't understand it either.
Wreck other people's karma, man.
All right, so I know that you know that we have one aspect of Bulletproof Underwear is a game show, and we're pretty flexible on that. It's just like usually a trivia kind of a show. We could very well have you and Frozen Sword back in a competition of a Halo lore off, and just see if you could reclaim the title.
I think I'd be down with that. I would absolutely love that. A third party action coming up with the questions and stuff like that.
We would get a bunch of questions from other sources, because I'm not an expert myself. I look to you and Frozen Sword for that.
There's always more to learn. There's always more to learn. And he hit me hard. He hit me with some like very, very specific questions. Like, what is the middle name of a certain starship captain? I can't even tell you the name of him now, but I think that was one I remember. he got me with some very, very specific questions, so I wouldn't mind a rematch.
So how did it work? Did you throw up questions for him and he threw up questions for you?
Yep, and I kept score and recorded it and everything, and unfortunately he came out on top on that one. But I think a third party would probably really make a huge difference. I would love to see that.
Lex, we have our marching orders.
Yep.
We have our marching orders. Let's gather up some good questions. Maybe have like a half hour.
You can make that happen.
I'd be down with that. I'm sure Frozen might be up for that too.
Well, I don't know. He'd be putting his bragging rights on the line. I don't know if he'd want to risk
He's already said that he would do that. I think he's good to go.
Well, he's a pretty confident fella. I think he believes that he could prevail.
Never know.
I'd
be interested. I'd be interested in seeing that.
Yeah,
they will have to have a tiebreaker sometime.
So, watching the PAX show yesterday. What were some of your thoughts on what they released at PAX?
First off, my thought is November 11th cannot get here quicker. And I'm serious. Oh, that was my first thought. Just watching everything they revealed is just, God, they're putting so much into this, and it's just $60. It's just unreal. This whole content package is $60.
This game should be at least $150, man.
That's what I thought it was going to be. I figured, you know, $125, $150.
Yeah, you would think. I mean, you're talking four games, every multiplayer map, including all the PC maps, all of it on 1080p, 60 frames per second, and all the multiplayer is on dedicated servers.
Every map ever released.
Every map ever released, and that includes all the PC maps. So some of these maps, some people have never played, ever.
Never been on the console.
Yep, they've never been on the console. I've played some on the Halo CE, because I played Halo CE on the PC. Some of them I liked, some of them I didn't. But other than that, there's just so much. There's so much. And we have Forge on top of it. And now that, to me, is just unreal.
Right. And yesterday was the first time they've actually gone into any kind of detail about what Forge is going to be like on the Master Chief Collection. What did you think about what we found out?
I'm liking it. I really am. They got a lot of stuff. Unfortunately, they did not give us any actual demos on stuff.
Right. They went through it pretty quickly. There was a screenshot where they listed all the add-ons and changes and everything, and that was probably the most elucidating. But
what it said, I mean, honestly, what it said on that screenshot was a lot of really good information. I mean, it really was, but unfortunately, we didn't get any live demos. I'm just going to look that up real quick. I got this right here. I'm planning on making a video on it very soon.
Yeah.
But
well, it looks like just the ability to snap things and the ability to mirror, make a reverse copy of stuff. That seems like
things. They're fixing the magnets, which is amazing. I use magnets, but I have to usually go back and fix the locations. Use the magnets kind of to put stuff where I want it to be, and then I have to readjust it afterwards, because if you turn it off, they would move. It was weird. I had maps. I had to literally go through. I'd create a map, and I would literally have to go through and readjust just about every piece because magnets or inconsistencies. So that is a huge deal. It's going to save me a lot of time when I'm making a map.
So I think we're going to see some pretty amazing creations from the community.
Yeah, I do.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The community is just amazing what they can create. I created a video. It's been a little while now, but it was basically a Forge art. People literally went to Forge, and they made these, like, dragons. And I've seen an Optimus Prime before. And, I mean, they were really well done. It's not some stuff that was just half-assed. I mean, it was really well done. The amount of time to do that, I just can't even imagine.
This seems like this could appeal to a lot of those Minecraft-type people who like to just build elaborate stuff, just put some time in and just make something amazing.
Yeah.
So you Minecraft nerds out there, sorry. You Minecraft people out there, hey, you should get on this Master Chief Collection. You can create some amazing stuff.
Hello, and welcome to the Halo PAX Prime Showdown. We're here
like the mirrored versions of objects.
Bravo, joined by Ghost Yami.
If you're putting in a staircase for something, and you're making a symmetrical map, and it's supposed to kind of work the opposite way, you couldn't do it before. You had to come up with some other means to do it. So it makes those pieces a lot more viable, which is ice.
Halo 2 anniversary multiplayer.
And a performance meter.
Thank you for your patience here as we get this tournament ready.
Your video.
And Ghost, we've got an awesome match ahead of us. It's triggers down and excellence.
Yeah.
Obviously, one of the biggest matches.
Did I lose you or what?
Waiting for
no, no, I can still hear you, but I can really hear.
And sure
I
enough,
can really hear some. You must
Sunday
be watching a stream or something.
With it, so
right. We knew we had to get this match on stream, so we'd like to thank you joining us here early in the morning.
Oh, wait, no. I know what it is. It's me. It's me.
Let's look at the bracket here of this match. Excuse me, of this tournament.
Sorry, guys.
No more medicinal before the show.
Okay, so I had to mute it. So they're starting back up the PAX stream on Halo.
Oh, yeah, it's coming up soon. It's coming up soon.
Yeah. All right, sorry. I thought that was you crazed, but that was – it's like I had it open.
No, my internet's not that good, so I have to compartmentalize.
You have to pick and stick with that.
Yep.
Yeah. What do you think about Bravo and Ghost Yami? Are they cool or what?
I've never met them. Bravo just recently took over as a community manager. Used to be BS Angel's job. I don't know if he's really gotten into that spot yet. I mean, really comfortable with it. Because I think BS Angel, when she was in that spot, she would be tweeting out to the fans, and she would respond to a lot more stuff. Bravo doesn't seem to do that. I don't know why. Maybe it's just a vast amount of tweets or whatever else he gets. But doesn't seem to respond as quickly to the community. So other than that, I think he does seem like a pretty cool guy.
Yeah.
I definitely
he seems like a cool
the,
guy. He's a well, people can take what he says, you know, with a little bit of credential because he is such a good Halo player himself.
Yes, so, he is a very good player.
So, yeah.
I've never gone against him, but I can imagine it probably would be a short match.
Yeah, and Ghost, Ghost, what does he do for 343?
Ghost is actually, my guess, I don't think they've officially said what he does, but Ghost Yami is more or less helps the balancing side of Halo. They hired, 343 hired like a whole slew of professional players.
Pros, which, yeah.
Yeah, they brought them in and so they could go in there and say, this is working, this is not working, this is overpowered, this is underpowered, and really focus on that, which is amazing because the Master Chief Collection is coming out this year, and that is amazing in itself. But coming December, we are getting our hands on the Halo 5 beta. Now, that's where I think, yeah.
Yeah, that's going to be.
I'm going to be all over it. I am going to be all over that
beta.
We
get it for a long time, man. We get it for 3 weeks.
We get that beta for 3 weeks, and I'm going to be in it, and I am going to be all over them forums and saying, this is what's working good, and this is what isn't. I mean, that's what 343 needs. They did not do it with Halo 4, and granted, I don't think they had the option. I really don't. I think Microsoft said, you're going to be putting this game out this year, and that's end of story. So I think 343 said, well, we got to get this done. We're going to have to cut this, this, and this, and this.
Well, it took them a while before they started really listening to the community. I mean,
yeah.
when was the famous Turbo update? It was after, like, how long?
It was June. I remember that. I made a video out, like, immediately after because I played it, and it just felt so much better. The game played, like, 100 times better than it did. Granted, we still have Infinity, which I really don't like Infinity, but the game itself, it plays
drops.
So much better. Ordnance drops. Oh, don't even get me going.
Yeah. Well, it seems to me that I would actually probably like it more, even if we're not playing Infinity, if there was just a little bit fewer weapons on the map, too. It seems like they kind of are very, very generous with giving out stuff. I don't know.
They can be. I think Infinity is the biggest problem. I think that is the biggest problem, mainly because of ordnance drops. And then they had to make concessions because of that. Because of ordnance drops, you're going to notice a weapon despawn time is incredibly short. I think it's like 10, 12 seconds, something like that. So if you get killed, I mean, you call in an ordnance drop, and I've had this happen more than once, and you get this awesome weapon, and you pick up the sniper. And the sniper across the map picks you off in a one shot. And next thing you know, it's like, oh, I just got that sniper. And you run back.
And it ain't there.
And it's gone. And it's gone. And it's like, well, that's not good. But that's what ordnance drops have caused. And I'm glad to see that disappear because that is such a pain. I can't even tell you. I've just had so many matches where I just got this awesome thing, real gun, whatever, and it's like, yep, it's gone.
Yeah, I really like the real gun. It's so satisfying when you get a kill.
The real gun is like one of my favorite things in Halo 4. Easily.
Yeah, you see that red reticle and you know you're home free, baby.
I actually made a real gun tips video. And It's interesting just how accurate that weapon can be. I set up a forge area like way across a map, and I shot the little pieces off and shot the little mine pieces. It can be very, very accurate, which is nice.
Well, I always think of it more of a close to mid-range weapon than a really long-range weapon.
It's a lot easier close to mid-range. But, man, if you get good at it and you get a good connection, it is such a satisfying gun. But the downside of that is that the connections. And with Halo 4, the host issues, peer-to-peer system, which I'm glad is going away, you're going to see – I've literally shot somebody in the face with a rail gun, and they just walk away from it. And it's like, oh, my God. And Scattershot has the same inconsistencies.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I've like meleeed a person twice from behind and still didn't even get a kill.
Dedicated servers, I'm telling you.
All right, this is Microsoft's dedicated servers. This is going to be the Microsoft Cloud, I'm pretty sure, right?
Yeah, we're going to be working with that, and it's granted you're not going to cure every bit of lag. There's just no cure for that. Bad connections are bad connections.
If you're playing from somebody from a long way off from you. Or the other of you is going to have a worse lag situation.
It's like when I'm playing with Modest Major. He's in the UK and I'm over here. It's usually not too bad, but sometimes there are just some matches there's just no recovering from.
Right. Well, I mean, for a signal to go all the way from across the Atlantic Ocean, that's like a half a second or something right there.
Yeah, And people don't realize that, if you have the best connection in the world, you got a 100 megabyte connection, that signal still's got to travel. And trust me, when I was overseas and I would call home, I would literally have to say what I was going to say, and then I would have to wait like a second or two, and then they would respond because that's just how long the travel time is.
Right. And
you can't get around the speed of light.
That's it.
You can't get around it.
Well, there's a slip space drive, you know, that you can do in Halo, but
there you go.
We need some of that Halo tech now.
Yeah. Yes, we do. Because they got deep space communications over faster than speed of light, so there we go.
That's it. So Titanfall, when it came out, it was only on the Xbox platform, and it was on Xbox's Azure Cloud. And I found, say whatever you want about Titanfall, but the connections.
Okay, that, I will.
Yeah, what do you think? I thought the connections were as good as any multiplayer I've ever played.
I was impressed.
I would agree. I was impressed. I've never had a laggy match ever. I play Battlefield 4 as well, and on dedicated servers.
But that's EA's dedicated servers.
Yeah, I have had very few issues with that too. I'm just being honest with you. I've had very, very few problems.
Really, you've had good.
Really,
luck
that's
with
not
them?
What that's not what you hear the scuttlebutt.
Well, you know, Battlefield 4 launched so poorly, and I think people were kind of upset. I didn't get into Battlefield 4 right away, so by the time I got it, most of the problems have been fixed. But I personally haven't had a whole lot of lag issues. That's just me. Maybe
what about
I'm just
crashes?
Lucky.
What about crashes?
I've had times where it would kick me out to the home screen. I was like, what is going on? playing campaign or something, it would do the same thing. I think they've fixed most of the problems. And I think EA, I think they took a major hit. I mean, you want to tell a company something, you tell them with your wallet. They will listen to that more than anything else.
Well, I think they have poisoned the well a little bit. When Hardline does come out, I predict they're going to have substantially lower sales than they had on Halo, on Battlefield 4.
I'd probably agree with that. But they did postpone it, if I recall. They did say it's not ready yet.
Yeah, it's all March, I think.
Well, I think people appreciate that. It's like, you know. Well, that's going to be kind of weird. It's like March. Does that mean the next game after that will also be in March?
I don't know.
Yeah, I hope they learn their lesson. I really do. I think I don't think that's just EA's fault, though, either. I think that was just the general consensus across the big companies, is that they say, we're going to have a game out at this time, and you're going to have it ready. Microsoft did it with Halo 4. EA did it with Battlefield 4. They're forcing these companies to put out products that aren't ready.
Right. Well, they got to get in on that Christmas, that Christmas sales.
But in the long run, you're hurting your business because if it's not ready, that's what they're going to walk away with. I mean, Halo 4, I'm going to tell you, Halo 4 on launch day had over 400,000 people playing. And that is, and that was just at one time.
Wow.
That was at one time.
Wow.
That wasn't an all-day thing. That was at one instant
concurrent.
Time.
Concurrent.
Yes.
And yeah. Oh, my God. It would be so sweet if it was still like that.
Yes. I think Master Chief's collection is going to be right up there. I think the pre-order numbers are a bit misleading.
Yeah. Frozen Sword is telling us in his articles that it looks like it might not be as big of a seller as we're hoping that it's going to be.
See, I personally, I'm getting the game, but I have not pre-ordered it. And the reason I haven't is because Phil Spencer said that they are going to start doing these pre-downloads.
Right. They already announced that they're going to do that for Destiny coming out next week.
For select games, they're going to do that. Now, me, where I live, there is no midnight opening, and I can go get the game and have it home installed, and I'll be... because it's probably going to take a couple hours, or not a couple hours, but it's going to take a little while to install everything and get it ready to go.
Right.
And I don't have that. I'm going to have to wait, get up the next day, go somewhere, go get it, then come home. And granted, it's only probably a few hours, but you know what? I don't want to wait a few hours. I want to play Master Chief Collection at midnight.
Yeah.
And if I could do this pre-download and at midnight on November 11th, I'm going to be online playing matchmaking.
Right.
That's what I want. So I think the pre-order numbers are a bit misleading at this point. I wouldn't go consistently on that. I think you are going to see some major, major Halo players playing on Master Chief Collection November 11th and November 12th. You're going to see some huge numbers.
Right. So even if – well, even if Frozen Sword is absolutely right, it's still going to be a big seller, and there's going to be so many more people playing than there is on Halo 4 or Reach or Halo 3 right now.
Yep. And they're offering Halo Channel looks really interesting, and I think
what do you think about that?
I think it's going to be the replacement for Halo Waypoint on Xbox One, but I think they're doing some really cool stuff. I think they're going to have a spectator mode in that. Granted, I think it's going to work through Twitch, but I think it's going to be a spectator mode. Now, that is a huge, huge deal because tournaments are already starting to pop up everywhere. People are beginning to want to watch Halo again. They're going to want to watch all those Halo 2 tournaments. I'm personally planning on hosting some. I really want to have a lot of awesome tournaments, probably some 2v2s, some Forge maps, all sorts of crazy stuff like that. And I think Halo Channel is really going to support that in a big way. So I'm really looking forward to seeing a lot more detail on that.
Right. Well, I don't think they've done a very good job of really explaining what exactly the Halo Channel is going to be good for. I mean, you know, if you want to go watch the TV show, yeah, sure. You can watch it on that, and it's like, and maybe look at your stats. But like, how is this going to really be, you know, different than Waypoint?
Well, from what I understand, and granted, I would agree with you. They have not explained it all that well, but it's going to have a lot of interactive things. If you want to give them 343 some feedback, the Halo Channel is a good place to do that. At least from what I understand, they're going to ask questions, do surveys. Plus, you're going to be able to see a lot of the community channels that are there that you can go and watch. At least that's what I'm thinking. And of course, you're going to have your Forward Unto Dawn. You're going to have your Halo Nightfall. And you can be able to watch that from the Halo channel as well, which is going to be good.
I wonder how where else you can watch the Nightfall channel. Is it going to be like on Netflix or something, or Hulu, or is it just going to be on the Halo channel?
Forward Unto Dawn is on Netflix.
That's how I thought.
I could see that being put put on Netflix eventually. It probably won't be right away. It's going to be episodic, so it's be about five episodes, I think it is. And it's probably going to take us right up into Halo 5 beta.
Right. So the plot is going to be between Halo 4 and Halo 5, right? The Nightfall series.
Yep.
And we're going to find out some information about Agent Locke.
Yes. The mysterious Locke.
Yeah.
So I still say I still say he's a Spartan 3. I think he was a Spartan 3. I could be wrong. But we don't know a whole lot about Agent Locke yet, but my guess is that he's a Spartan 3.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you know, it was really cool seeing those scenes where you can see the actual weapons. You can see the battle rifle and the DMR and the pistol, and they look so cool.
The amount of detail they went into that is just wow.
If they ever put up a BR or something like that on eBay from the show, I wonder what it would sell for.
I don't know, but man, I've seen some really good stuff out there in my day, and yes, the amount of detail and the amount of production quality in this, it's going to be something you're going to want to sit down and watch with the wife and kids and whatever else, because I just think it's going to be really good. Maybe not the kids, because I don't know what we're going to see yet.
Yeah,
it would be kind of cool if we actually saw some Flood action again.
Are they going to have like computer generated aliens and stuff like that, or people in rubber costumes, or what?
I don't know. I would say something more CG, some more CG style. You know, you got Forward Unto Dawn. I thought the Elites looked really well done. Granted, it was all dark and whatever else, but it looked good. I thought it looked good, considering the production value.
Yeah. I watched that twice. I watched it a long time ago, and then I just re-watched it recently, just trying to get up my Halo lore as much as I can. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to your series that you have, because, you know, I don't know. It's like, I think it's like all the Halo old-timers are definitely going to be getting the Master Chief Collection. Do you think it's going to bring in a lot of people who've never played a Halo game before?
You know what? I have actually thought of that myself, and it's going to be hard to guess. I mean, it really is. I think there's going to be some of it is going to be a lot of people are going to be swept up in the hype, which is understandable. At least I think it is. And I think the interesting thing to me, and this is what I really want to put out there, is that some of these people out there have only played Halo Reach and Halo 4. Now, Halo Reach and Halo 4 are not the more traditional Halo games by any means. They got the armor abilities, and of course Halo 4 brought in ordnance drops and stuff like that. My actual curiosity is how are the newer players going to react to the older games that don't have that? There's just pretty much straight up arena gameplay and positioning, weapon knowledge,
they've been
map
brought up
knowledge.
They've been brought up on Call of Duty and Titanfall and Battlefield.
And yeah, that's what I'm really curious about, see how they're going to respond to the older games.
Well, it's going to seem a little simple. It's going to seem a little simple for people who are used to those complicated AAA titles that have been coming out for the last few years.
It might seem, I think you're probably right in that, is that it's going to seem simple, but it's not. I mean, it's literally, like we were talking about earlier, is that there is so much to learn. I mean, literally, last night watching the Twitch broadcast, I literally found a new jump that I did not know was there on Lockout, and jump up from the side up to the top of the BR station. I did not know that was there. Now I do. I mean, there's just so much little things that you got to learn, and it's going to be there. That's where it's deceptively simple. At least I think that. I'm really curious. They're not going to have all the crazy ordnance drops, custom loadouts, and everything else. They're going to have, you know, of course, Halo 4 able to play that. But in the older games, it's not going to be there.
I'm curious about the graphics because, all right, so we already know on Halo 2, there's going to be 6 maps that are going to be completely reimagined with the kind of textures that you would expect.
On an Xbox One, yeah.
On the Xbox One. But what about Halo CE and 3? Are they going to be just exactly the same as they were back 10 years ago?
Technically, yes, but no. They're receiving an upgrade to 1080p.
They're getting an upgrade to 1080p, 60 frames. But are the textures going to be as sort of... You know, when I played the CE anniversary game, I played with the textures turned off just because I wanted the more authentic experience. I like the new textures, but I just like, I want to try this old school.
Yam, the textures and graphics are going to be so great, Yam. You'll be able to see two flies screwing if they're flying around on the screen.
that's essentially the truth right there.
The
textures are going to be the exact same. They're just going to look crisper and prettier and smoother. They're running 60 frames a second, so yeah, they're going to be extremely smooth. Definitely, I can't wait to see that. And I've been asking, I've been tweeting out to Bravo, and I've been tweeting out to Dan Ayoub, is that I want to see some side-by-side pictures of Halo 3, Halo 4, and of course, Halo 2 and Halo CE. I want to see side-by-side comparisons. The old... seriously, yeah.
Like the same exact spot from both games.
Yep, you're looking at... I'm trying to think here. Halo CE, that was 480. That was 480p.
It couldn't even have been 480 because TVs in those days, they didn't even have the 5-pin. They had just the left-right audio and then the little yellow... thing. So that's not even 480.
Probably isn't. That's a huge upgrade. I want to see that. I want to see exactly how well it looks. I mean, you're going to probably see things like the Warthog tread tires. You're going to see that just like be so much crisper. So it's an upgrade, but it's not retextured. If that answers the question.
All right.
I definitely want to see 343 put that out.
Yeah. Now, Halo 4, they're not going to need to do much to the Halo 4 because it already looks pretty amazing on 360.
Yeah, it does. I think they said you're going to notice a few things here and there, but Halo 4 is actually extremely crisp as it is. You probably aren't going to see a whole lot of improvement other than it's going to be running a lot smoother.
Yeah.
You're going to notice that immediately. Mm-hmm. But other than that, Halo 4 is literally the prettiest game I have ever seen on the 360.
It's amazing. It really is.
It is. And they literally pushed that 360 to its limits. I don't think they could squeeze another ounce out of it.
They spanked that 360 till it was screaming.
Yeah, they got that bitch slammed against the wall, man.
Just a hammering.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh. So my big question is, when you get your Halo Master Chief Collection up and running, what's the first thing you're going to do?
That is a huge question. A lot of people have asked that same thing, and I personally have already planned. I'm going to watch Halo Nightfall first. I'm going to watch that. It's going to be probably about 15, 20 minutes. I'm going to already get started into that because it looks amazing already. The trailer is phenomenal. And I want to know about Age of Locke. I want to know more about him. But then, here the thing I'm going to do next is a little inconsistent for me. Because usually when I get a Halo game, the first thing I do is I play through the campaign period. That's what I do. But I've already played through every single campaign multiple times. So I'm going to back off on that. I'm going to jump into probably some Halo 2 multiplayer. I want to get on to some of that.
Yeah. You're going to see those new reimagined maps.
Yep, I want to see those. I just want to play the old Halo 2 maps because I did not really get to play a whole lot of Halo 2 back in the day when it was a prime time. I think, and I've said this before on other places, but I think I've played probably, if I played 24 Halo 2 games, I think that's probably an overestimate. And I've played more of Halo CE because I played on the PC. But yeah, I want to play some Halo 2. I want to play that. I want to play on every single map.
Yeah. So over the long haul, over the life of the Master Chief Collection, what do you think is going to be the most played Halo on there, multiplayer-wise?
My guess, and just a guess right now, is I think it's going to be Halo 2. I think that's going to be the... I think so.
So because I want to get good as I can get, I think I'm going to focus on Halo 2.
I think that's where the action is.
That's where the action is, yeah.
Yeah, everybody's. That's all I'm hearing. Is people are saying Halo 2. So it's like, that's where I'm going to jump.
Now, I would probably do the best at Halo 4 because I already am familiar with it somewhat. So I'm going to probably get my ass handed to me on a big fat platter over and over again on Halo 2.
Well, actually, I got to give you credit here, Yamjuice. I got to give you credit is that you're already getting ahead of the game because a lot of people, this is going to be day one for their Halo experience, and you're already above that. So you're going to do something. You're going to do some killing.
Okay.
What I really, really like the best is that they're actually incorporating ranks this time. And it's going to be in-game.
Right.
You know, I think we played some matches the other night when we got done after we just got stomped.
Yeah.
I went and you have to go and look up the ranks on Halo Waypoint, which is a pain. But I have a computer sitting next to me when I'm playing, so... I go and look it up, and it's like, 50, 50, 47. I was like, well, it's no friggin' wonder we just got stomped. Why are we playing with these guys? And fortunately, that's just the nature of the beast right now because there's just not a lot of players on.
Right. You can't break it up.
You can only separate it so much because of just the player count as it is. And, of course, when you play with a team, which we're playing as a group, the actual matchmaking system looks for other groups. So we're kind of shooting ourselves in the foot a little bit by just doing that. But that's how it works.
Well, I've noticed that there's some games where I do really good. And I can tell I'm playing weak players. When I get into other games, it's like these players are so much stronger than these other players are. So there's like a wide, wide range that you get into on Halo 4 right now.
Yeah. You could get into any kind of match right now. It's really hard to find a match that is really right on par with what your level is. I think that's going to go away. I think that is with Halo Master Chief Collection. I think you're going to see a lot more consistent matches, a lot more matches that are come right down to the wire, which is what I love. I love
that's
those
more
matches.
Fun.
It is.
Yeah. Now, I don't know how Major's going to do because he's kind of like a pub stomper. It's going to be harder to shit on kids like that.
He might just start opening up new accounts again. You never know. He might do that.
Major of Mustard.
Major X. Of Miners. Major of this. Major of that. I was like, I can't even tell you how many alternate accounts he had for a while.
Yeah. But, so it has been announced that the Halo 2 ranking system is going to be used throughout the entire system.
Yes, I hope, and I really do. I hope they're going to split it up a little bit, like put your ranked on one side and your social on another, because they're just two different game styles.
I don't think they're going to have a social playlist.
I don't think they are either.
Who is he, that guy that came from Gears of War?
Quinn Del Hoyo?
Quinn Del Hoyo tweeted out that it's going to be one Halo for everybody.
He tweeted out, and I remember seeing that tweet. He basically said that he thinks everything should be ranked. I'm like, no, it shouldn't. You could go into Action Sack. Why would Action Sack be ranked? That's
like
just ridiculous.
Game.
Yeah, that's where your gun game is. All your other stuff that people create, all the odd, crazy game types. Why would you rank that? Seriously, yeah. That's just. I mean, Halo Reach, honestly, I think had the best Action Sack, in my opinion, because I think Halo Reach brought along a lot of really cool games. And, I mean, I remember playing Skee-Ball. Somebody made up a Skee-Ball map, and you could literally play that. And I thought that was amazing. Somebody made a hockey game and all sorts of other crazy stuff. And how are you going to put a rank on that?
Yeah, well, I guess we'll find out. But see, I think some people who are worried about a ranked playlist are thinking, oh, no, this is just going to help high-ranked, high-skilled players. It's like going to be all about them. But no, I think it's going to be really great for noobs.
It is.
Noobs can play other noobs. And it's like as you get better, then they'll put you in against tougher opponents. But while you're a noob, you'll be actually able to get some kills, and you'll be able to, you know, not be super, super frustrated. I think that's a great idea, not just for the high-level players, but also for people just getting started.
Yeah, the best thing about ranks, I mean, this is what I absolutely love about it, and the ranks literally show you, it's like, yes, I am getting better at this game. And then it motivates you. And then it becomes a bragging rights thing because you can go online and say, yeah, I'm a ranked 25. Yeah, well, I'm ranked 26. So there. And it inspires competition between you and your friends. And that is what I think is amazing about having ranks. And then while you're trying to get your 26, what are you doing? You're online. You're playing. You're getting more consistent matches. You're learning the maps. You're learning everything, learning all the little things so you could beat your friend. That is what I'm talking about with ranks.
Yeah, it's got to be heartbreaking when you get really crushed in a game and you drop a rank or two. It's like, oh, no.
Yeah. Unfortunately, there is that downside, but hopefully it's going to be a lot more consistent with the Master Chief Collection because there are going to be a lot more players online.
Right.
Yeah. That's what I was thinking. I think just from the bigger mass of players, as far as like even matchmaking will be better because you'll have a bigger pool to draw from.
Yeah.
So are they going to have DLC maps? They've already got so many maps. Are they going to have DLC packages?
DLC packages. I put out a video on that, and I honestly. It depends on how they're going to do it if they do DLC.
I saw your video. It was a really good video.
If they do it like Halo 3, or I'm sorry, Halo Reach and Halo 4, I'm going to say, you know what, don't even bother with the DLC. I mean, some people probably won't like that idea, but don't even bother because what's the point of having it if you never get to play it?
That shit never comes up. Yeah, you don't even get to play it.
Only on the rarest of occasions does it come up. And if they take the ideas that I went and they could expand on that in that video and do it that way, then, you know, I might be all for it. Definitely if they do it the Halo 2 style where they had it like time exclusivity for about 2-3 months and then they gave the maps
and then
free.
They gave it to everybody.
Yeah. That would be the ideal situation.
Because all it does is divide up the player base. And that's not good.
And then at that point, is people are going to get all these new maps, and they're going to want to play some more, and it's just going to be good.
Yeah. Well, that'll be interesting to see how they do it. You know that they're going to do it in Halo 5, of course, but when there's so many maps, it's almost like, why would you need DLC?
I don't know.
You won't be able to get sick of all the maps because there's so many.
There's over 100 maps, and that's without Forge. That's without Forge. And think about that. If you start throwing in Forge maps, you're talking, depending on what they want to put in, you could have 150, 200 maps. Can have a lot. And some Forge creators out there, I think Kiki Wolfkill said it yesterday, some of the Forge maps that are created are better than what they make.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Well, that's what the Major was saying just the other day. So he's saying that the Forge maps kind of came in and saved the day for Halo 4 because they weren't that crazy about the initial offerings.
Yeah.
So who do you think is going to blow up when the Master Chief comes out, the YouTube scene?
Me, my channel. Ha ha ha. Me giving health reports. Ha ha ha.
Yeah, that's it. Crazed, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here. I'm just my wife's here. Give me 2 seconds.
Hi.
Oh, sure. Hi, hi, wife. Mrs. Crazed.
Mrs. Crazed.
Hopefully, you're not quite as crazed.
As crazy as he is.
Lady Crazed.
All now, right.
I'll be. Give me 2 seconds here, fellas. Sorry.
Oh, sure. No problem.
No problem. No problem.
No worries.
So what do you think about that Crazed Spartan guy, Flex? He seems like a really nice fellow.
I like him.
I like him because he's old like us.
I got to play with him. I haven't played with him yet, so.
Yeah, yeah.
We got to play some Halos.
Some Halos. Halos before hoes. Oh, man. It's time for a cig here.
Flavor Country.
Got my Rockstar. You know, fortunately, I thought I spilt a lot of that Rockstar. It was just enough to get me a little wet.
Yeah, always scared me when you did that, man. I thought you poured it all over your fucking laptop.
Yeah, I know. Just yesterday, for the first time ever, I took this laptop apart and went after it with a can of compressed air. This thing is from 2011. It was a very high-end laptop at the time. It's still holding up pretty good as far as specs and stuff, but it was overheating and just crashing, totally dying. So, yeah.
Yeah, I hate it when that happens.
So, yeah, I just cleaned out my laptop crazed yesterday, and it's like now it's cool as a cucumber. I'm feeling the exhaust fan. It's like, oh, yeah, so much cooler than it was.
Oh, yeah, I run laptop, too, and it does get hot. I don't know why.
Cat hair in mine. We got two cats, so it's like I get cat hair.
I had cats, dogs, and rabbit.
Oh man!
I got a friggin' farm.
So we got to see your face. Was that the first time on that ALS bucket challenge? Was that the first time you showed your face?
That would be correct.
I have
my reasons. I don't like doing that, and it's not because I'm hideous or anything, but I do have a reason I don't like to show face cam. I'm kind of along with Major, and I don't want to be like, look at the what did he say? The monkey clown or whatever he said. I can't remember. He just goes off sometimes. It's just hilarious. But that's part of it. But I do have another reason, which I don't want to get into. But
I know what it is. The mob. Is got the a contract mob. Out on you. They're after you, and it's like you got to stay low.
They're after the crazed.
That's right. It's too late for Flex and me. We're our faces are plastered. You know.
Yep. You guys are all over.
I've broken many camera lenses. So.
Yeah. It's like people have said some mean things in some comments before, but I don't care. I'm 55, and it's like. Hey, when you get 55, let's just see what you look like, son of a gun.
I'll get over it.
Yeah. So, Craze, how old are you exactly again?
I am a geezer. I'm 38.
38.
I'm the official OG, like you said, old guy.
That's right. You're sort of a pup compared to me and Flex, but in actual gamer years, you might as well be a million.
Yeah, unfortunately, you are right in that.
Once you bypass that, like, 25 to 30 range, I think you, like, kind of turn into the geezer status.
But honestly, I think it opens up a lot of things you don't understand. And at least I know you guys do, is like, I'm 38 years old. If I want to go and get an Xbox One, I can go get an Xbox One.
Exactly.
And if I want to get a PlayStation 4, granted, my wife would probably say, what are you doing? But I could deal with that. But
I remember in my younger days, it was like, you know, you had to really pick and choose carefully and plan every move like that. But as a grown-up man, I'm a full-grown man. If I want it, I'm going to get it, damn it.
Yeah. if I, I'm not sitting here trying to beg mom and dad or whatever else, and going out and getting a job. Well, I already have a job, but you know what I mean? I'm not having to go the extra mile, so it gives me a lot more leeway in a lot of stuff. Right. And it actually gives me a lot more leeway in doing YouTube as well, because I'm not worried right now. But I'm not in college. I'm not in high school worried about tests and things like that. I got my job. I got my wife. I got my family. And then I got YouTube. And then my wife is bantering me in the background.
you have a good-looking family. Those girls look like you should be proud.
I am. They are some troubles at times, and they're getting to be teenagers pretty quick. Actually, one of them is, and
I got a teenager. I got a fresh.
she just turned 13.
Just turned 13, boy.
Oh yeah, yeah. I'm there. Luckily, she's more of a homebody, but I think when the second one gets there, I think that's probably when the real trouble is going to start.
Yeah. Well. Them's the brakes clean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's all right, though. I wouldn't trade them for the world. They're my my girls. And your girls.
Now, I don't have any kids that I know of. My wife has, like, grown-up kids. Like, I think one's 30-something, and the other is just about to turn 30.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm not there yet. I got some years.
No. You got some years, yeah. But it happens fast. When I first met her youngest was only 15, and like he was a punk kid, and now he's a grown ass man. Time slips away, man. It really does.
Time, you know what? And I didn't particularly believe it when I was younger, but man, when you get older, time goes by faster. I don't know why. I mean, literally, we're staring at September. We're staring at September right now, and it feels like we just had 4th of July. Yeah. Seriously.
Speaking of September, 1 week and 1 day from
321.
Now, midnight is going to be the Destiny launch. What do you think about that?
Oh, you bringing up Destiny.
We have to. It's too close.
Yeah.
Oh,
what's your opinion?
I'm going to be a wait and see type of person with Destiny. I've played the beta, and I absolutely realized that it was a beta. However, with my background in my gaming history, playing World of Warcraft and stuff like that, I understand probably a little better than some other people do on how fast people go through content. And I think Destiny's going to be a good game, but I think people are going to eat up that content extremely fast. And where do you go when there's no more fresh content? You go to the Crucible.
Right.
Or the online matchmaking, and that was a horrible experience for me. I did not like it at all.
Thank you. Thank you for agreeing with me.
It's like I was like, this is pissing me off so much.
Yeah.
Damn.
Disappointed. That was me. More disappointed than pissed. I was
both. It's like,
I'm sitting there. What was those stupid things? The control things. You had to go and capture the control things. And I found out later on that doesn't even matter. I mean, you could capture them, and the only thing it does is just increases the amount of points you get per kill. So you could win a match without even capturing any single one of those. But sitting in there, getting the control point, and then around comes a warlock or something, and just does a one hit super Nova bomb thing on me. I was like, what the?
this is like ordnance drops on hyper steroids.
Yeah, and like Major said, and you get that golden pistol has an aim assist from God knows where. That's practically three given kills, especially if you go into one of those control points and you got people kind of trying to control it. And I don't know. I was not very impressed with the multiplayer, and the moon map I absolutely hated. Hated.
Oh man! Oh, I was cursing. I was cursing the stupid tank thing.
Yeah. That tank thing, and you couldn't hardly get them out of it. Once they were in it, they were in it.
Well, they actually finally did it. They took the objective out of an objective-based game, you know?
Yeah. I mean,
there's no more PTFO, man. It's just PT.
Yeah. So, you know, that puts us in the minority of people who are not crazy looking forward to Destiny. It's like record-setting pre-orders. I mean, no other game has ever hit this high of pre-orders.
I absolutely realize that, and you know, I've gotten into, I wouldn't say an argument, but a debate with some people online with the wife. No, she doesn't care one thing or another about Destiny, but she's waving at me. But I think the appeal is the PvE, and at least if I was to get into it at all, it would be that. I think it's going to be good. But I think it's going to be limited. And they're already talking about expansions. So how much is an expansion? Are we talking another game's worth? Are we talking $12? How often is that going to come? I mean, they're talking 10 years of life or something with this game. And that's a lot of time, and that's a lot of money. So I don't know. I just not thrilled with Destiny. I just don't think it's going to have the content or the staying power of other games.
That's what I hear more than from everybody that I hear from that has, you know, something to say about it, is staying power. They're, you know, concerned, is it going to have staying power? I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either.
Well, just a month after, just about 2 months after it comes out, both Call of Duty and Master Chief hit. So I think, you know, their player numbers are going to plummet drastically when those two games come out.
And Assassin's Creed Unity, which they moved to the same date as Master Chief Collection comes out.
Yeah, yeah. We have to compete with Assassin's Creed.
I don't think that's going to be a big competition.
Yeah, I think they're different kind of players.
What I think is interesting is that I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Advanced Warfare comes out like a week before Master Chief.
A week before Master Chief.
This is just the opposite of the Halo 4, because it came out a week after Call of Duty Black Ops 2. And I literally, once that game came out, you saw the numbers drop in Halo 4 significantly. So I'm just kind of curious as to how all that's going to actually play out. I'm hoping Master Chief is going to dominate all, but that's just me. But I'm a realist, and I know that may or may not be the case.
Well, just the simple fact that the other games are going to be on all four consoles, where we're only going to be just on the Xbox One. Well, actually,
yeah,
that's it. The Master Chief is not coming on Xbox 360.
No, it can't do it.
So there's no possible way that just the raw numbers are going to favor the Master Chief Collection, just because it's only going to be people who have the Xbox One, and that's a pretty limited number of people.
And that's going to be a system seller. I've already know of several people. I don't know if you play with him the other night or not, but I think he's already said that, when Master Chief Collection, he's going to have an Xbox One just for that game. And I don't think
he's
going to
be
one.
System seller. It always has been.
Yeah.
It's like Halo made Xbox.
Yeah, it did. It did. Halo made Xbox Live, period. Halo made Xbox Live.
It made the Xbox in the original. It's like, if there's anything that Xbox needs to get on their knees and kiss the soles of their feet, it's Halo.
Yeah. I think I remember reading some of the history. And just before Halo 2 launched, they were asking how many servers or, you know, how many what they should have. And they, at the time, Xbox Live wasn't very big. I mean, we still had vast majority was LAN games at the time. But Halo 2 was coming, so they wanted to have more servers. So they put out three plans. The plan was like, well, let's have plan A has like 50,000. Plan B has like, you know, 125,000. And then the big plan, which nobody would have thought went to, I think it was like 250,000 players on at any given time. So the servers could handle it. And Xbox went with the big numbers. And it surprised them at the time because this was unheard of. I mean, you got to remember, this was unheard of to have this many players on one game at one time. It was unheard of.
Yep.
And then Halo 2 launched. And granted, it needed a patch and everything, but it was immediately filled up and they had like zero server issues. By zero server issues, I mean the servers weren't shutting down because of overload and stuff like that.
Right.
But I mean, Halo 2 literally made Xbox Live.
It did. It made Xbox Live. Now, at that time, what year did it come out? It came out in
2004.
Yep.
Yeah, in 2004, a lot of people still had dial-up internet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'll venture a guess that Halo has probably converted a lot of people over to high-speed internet at the time.
They did. Because it made it broadband only. If you wanted to play it, you had to have broadband. I think right. Xbox itself did that. And that was a good choice. That was a very, very good choice. It really promoted that. And granted, broadband back then and broadband now are a little different.
Right, but dial-up, I mean, oh, my.
Yeah.
I remember dial-up when it was literally you had the modem sitting next to the computer, and it would do that noise.
That noise.
it didn't even mute the noise, but you heard all of that, and that's what I remember. And dial-up, what was it, 5800 or something like that? That was top speed. I was like, oh, my God, yeah. I got some speed. And it would take literally probably a minute to download a picture, one picture.
Yeah, yeah.
Good times.
And then Xbox 360 came out, and when they finally did release Halo 3 – by that time, the adoption rate for broadband was probably pretty broad, and
yeah.
It's like from there, it's like Katie bar the door. Now online is a thing. Everybody's doing it, you know.
All the cool kids are doing it.
Yeah, all the cool kids are doing it.
and you know, ever since that time, you know, it's like pretty much almost every single game that comes out, even if it's totally tacked on, they'll usually have a multiplayer.
Yeah, yeah. Sadly, though, I think Titanfall, Titanfall had a really good multiplayer. Not a lot of depth to it, but it had a good multiplayer. It ran smooth. Everything was balanced. Really good. But the campaign was tacked on. The campaign was garbage.
They have balls to even call that a campaign.
That was the
who
worst.
Who do they think they're fooling? Who's buying that's a campaign?
I don't know. I played it, and I was like, what is this? This is worse than anything else I could imagine.
Are there any Titanfall lore, you know, experts?
I'm going to venture to say no. Frozen Sword and I did a episode on it, but honestly, if you just go through the campaign and you don't get anything out of it, you just play the multiplayer. That's what you're doing.
It's like I was like, "What the heck was that?" You know, you see the cutscene right before the game starts. It's like,
it's not even a good.
What
cut
did
scene.
I just see? What is this? What does this have to do with? It's like, why are we even doing this?
Compare. I think about this. Compare the Titanfall cutscenes with the Master Chief Collection cutscenes, the Halo 2 ones. And, oh, my God, the Halo 2 ones are phenomenal. The acting is 100 times better, and the graphics are about a million times better. Yeah, and they're cutscenes.
I have Titanfall on Xbox 360 and Xbox One, and I was shocked by how little difference there was.
Yeah,
I mean, you're not losing much by playing 360's version of the game.
No, no. And I think that's one of the downsides of making a game multi-platform is that they got to take into the fact that you are putting it on an older system as well as a newer system. So,
lowest common denominator.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's the way it rolls. So this actually year, I think, is going to be the first year we have actual exclusive titles to the next-gen consoles.
About damn time.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And you're going to start seeing the real differences, I think, because they're not trying to do that. Not trying to be able to shove this big game onto an Xbox 360 or a PlayStation 3, which you're going to see it, I think, come this year.
Yeah, well, you got to have some dadgum reason to buy a next-gen console. I mean, if they keep putting everything out on old-gen, it's like, yeah, well, I just keep my 360 or my PS3. I'm happy as a clam.
Yeah. They're starting to. I mean, the Master Chief Collection is definitely a big push in that direction. I think that alone is going to increase the Xbox One sales, bar none. I mean, it's just going to be amazing. But
well, also, I think they should make more arcade games for it. It's like, you know, they have like a little bit of arcade games for it, but it's like nothing like Xbox 360. If you go back and look at the games that you can buy, there's like millions and millions of games.
Yeah, there's go online. I think they're doing a lot more stuff with indie games right now. I think they're really starting to kick off that market, which is good. And they're putting some of those, I think, on the Xbox Live Gold with Games program. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Reach. Reach is coming out.
Yeah, Reach is coming out.
Games with Gold. So if you have a 360, you can get it for free.
September 16th.
Right.
No, so I got a friend that hasn't played.
Player numbers. Yeah. I haven't played it yet either. I have a disc.
Yam's got the disc, but he's never opened it or played it.
I haven't ever opened it. Let's see here.
Is that next to the BioShock Infinite disc?
It's still
there
sealed.
It is. Yay!
It's still sealed.
Still sealed.
Yep.
Reach had a good campaign. I have to say it had a really good campaign. It had an awesome custom games. Awesome. And they had a lot of stuff you could do in Halo Reach. Unfortunately, Halo 4 launched, I think, like I said, before it was ready, and the custom games was not supported as much. And you can see it. You can see it now, which is a shame.
Well, any way you slice it, the Halo custom games are just nobody can compare it. Like, Call of Duty has custom game modes. And, you know, I've played plenty of those. Flex and I used to have a game night that kind of fell by the wayside that we did every week of custom games. And you could do some fun little stuff, but compared to what craziness. You know,
strapping a holograph on a Uzi and putting a silencer on it type of stuff.
Yeah.
You know,
crazy shit, man.
But, yeah, Halo's custom games, it is just amazing what people have created. Like I said, I've played games of skee ball. I've seen a pinball game. This is with all within Forge, and people created this stuff. Taking things like ordnance drops, and they used them well. Like somebody made a musical chairs type of game, and that was just incredible. I mean, the stuff that people can create out there with this, the limited tools we had with Halo 4, it really gives me a lot of hope here in the future.
So that's the cool thing about Halo. There's so much for so many people. You've got Forge and custom games. You've got the competitive people. You've got the casuals. You've got people who like big team games with vehicles. You've got the people who like, you know, the tight 4v4 kind of games. It really has something for any kind of a player, and there's like hopefully a vibrant portion of the community for each and every one of those things is going to be happening.
Yeah, I think that's one of the biggest reasons I absolutely love Halo, bar none, any other game, because there's just so much. There's so much. You could do anything you want in that game. If you love the campaign, you love that lore, it's there. Halo has by far probably one of the best campaigns in any FPS I've ever played.
It's great, and after you've played it, you can go back and play it on a higher difficulty. You can end up playing it on Legendary. You can add skulls to make it super, super hard. Have you ever played a campaign with all skulls on in Legendary and got through it?
I have played it. I have tried it because in Halo Reach, they actually had these challenges, these weekly challenges. And Halo 4 has challenges, but they don't really matter because you get to 130 so quickly. But it was called they're called Lasso or Mythic Runs. Legendary all skulls on. And if you can complete that, my hat's off to you because I've tried it and I barely get past the first enemy engagement because it is just so difficult. And you literally have to plan your route and how you're going to go it and how you're going to kill each enemy with the minimal chance of getting killed yourself. Because yeah, if you're playing
it's
solo,
so hard.
If you're playing solo, you have the Iron Skull on. The Iron Skull. Basically, if you die, you start from the beginning. So if you get all the way to the end and you get some random fuel rod, guess what? You're doing it again.
No.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're doing it again.
So there's plenty to keep a person. If that's all you're even interested in is campaign, there's enough there to keep you busy for a long time.
Yes. Yes. And we're going to have achievements. We're going to have all sorts of Easter eggs. Halo is notorious for putting in Easter eggs. There's a bunch in Halo 4. There's a bunch in the past games as well. Halo 3 had a whole lot too. Some of one just got discovered probably recently. I think.
Yeah, I saw a video of that.
Yeah, it was. This game is 7 years old already, and this Easter egg was just finally discovered. I think it had somebody's birthday, birthday on it or something like that. I can't remember, but.
Well, I'm not into like discovering Easter eggs. That's not my deal. But I know that there is plenty of people who that's like something that's
yep.
really big on.
And one of the things that people absolutely love doing was breaking the campaign. And by that I mean getting outside the boundaries and going where you are not supposed to go. And there was a whole group that did that. There's another group that likes to do some crazy jumping. I haven't seen any videos on that lately, but man, some of the jumps that they could do and get to places of really, really talented people. Yeah, Halo has a little bit of everything, and that's why I love it.
That's it. So I think this is probably a pretty good time to end the podcast. So could we maybe hope to maybe someday get you back on the show?
If you ask me, I'd probably be glad to come back.
Yeah. We're crazed for Crazed Spartan. So okay, we're gonna do the same thing as we did with Major. Since we don't have a webcam on you, we're just gonna have to use some little digital magic.
Yay, digital magic.
I know that you use Sony Vegas to edit your videos.
Correct.
Yes, because I recognized your intro screens and stuff.
Yeah. Little
Sony Vegas, the greatest ever.
It is. I use that. And the reason I like it is because it doesn't crash on me. I've used other ones, and they just end up crashing. And Sony Vegas has been the most consistent. So that's what I'm using.
Yeah. So, all right. So, if you're still watching Bulletproof Underwear, episode number 113, good for you. Now get
Thank
a life.
You. Thank you.
No, we're just kidding. We love you. We love you.
we love you, but we don't love you.
That's it. Gandhi. You got to love that guy. So, this has been Bulletproof Underwear, episode number 113. I'm your co-host, Yamjuice.
And I'm your co-host, Flex.
And we'd like to send out a very heartfelt thank you for coming on the show and being with us today for Mr. Gray Spartan.
All yeah! Right. Hey, thanks for having me. I really do appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for coming on.
It was good. It was good. So now it's time.
Ah! Ah!
Don't worry, you'll be in on this. Your little avatar thing will participate. So there's only one thing left to do.
I will take us out then. Goodbye, everybody.